Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
You're still watching Game On. Now quickly in the Uganda Premier League, match day 6, they'd have Proline securing all 3 points, a 2-1 victory over Mukwano Gwabangan Express FC. But despite winning that game, they still remained rock bottom in the UPL. Elsewhere, we had Bright Stars and URA. They had nothing to show. Both sides in Bright and URA settling for a point. While Maroons FC, their three-match unbeaten run was ended by Bull FC, who are now on top of the pile with the two fine goals right there from Iwan Robert. For Chetume, well, falling out to Police FC, coming their first win of their campaign. As for Soga United, back-to-back defeats away Mbara City. Proline, like I said earlier on, peeping out on Express FC. We'll be starting with Proline, of course, Express FC, an inspiring effort there from Mustafa Mojizu, who has become a pillar to that club side. But a very, very fine performance here from Matilde, who desperately needed to get back to winning ways domestically, having been quite impressive in the CAF games.
I think for Proline, all they do is Paul Moomizar on George Semogeria and his Express side, because you have the sense that, even when Disan Kaliwango came through as the team captain and he led Express in terms of scoring the goal, they lacked that edge. They lacked that desire to come out to Lugogo and go out with all the 3 points. And I think for me, I mentioned Mustafa Mujuzi. You know, you've got players like Nordin Bunjo, the team captain. These guys have been absolutely brilliant for Proline. For Matia Lule, at the end of the day, it was always going to be about collecting those 3 points, because it's going to be very important that they collect as many points as possible before the end of the first round, because after being docked 3 points, it's about kicking on. And I think for me, they played like a team that was at home. They played like a team that wanted to take all the 3 points, and certainly 2-1 is a very commendable result against a team like Express, but it leaves Express in quite the daunting task, because they are still stuck in the relegation zone and they are struggling to pick up results.
Briefly, for Bull FC, coming out to do away with Maroons FC, who had come out prior to that defeat yesterday, three straight wins. But from yesterday, we had Mugokotia Robert scoring a breast, a result that means that Bull FC temporarily lead the pile if Vipers do come out and fall out to AC Villa.
I look at this Bull team, and I think for me, the only blemish to their campaign so far has been that loss they had to Busoga United in the Ginger Derby. But beyond that, they've had quite a scintillating performance and started the campaign. And you're thinking, for these junior teams, we've got to put a little bit more focus on them, because they come out to play for results. They are not teams that will come out and play a very fluid kind of game, but they know how to dig out for a performance. They'll know how to come out there and take a result. And I think for me, for a team like Bull coming out there and beating up on Maroons, it's one of those results that gives them a lot of confidence, because they beat a team that has been high-flying going into the game, and it's one of those that they'll actually be looking to build on for the rest of the first round.
Well, for another time, we'll be having a game played under the floodlights. That is, of course, Vipers, former league champions, away to the 16-time league champions in AC Villa. In form, Fahad Bayo coming out to show some positivity as he looks forward to get more goals for the Venoms later tonight away to the Jogos. Those, of course, are the fixtures set to happen tonight. Toro at home against KCFC, who have only played 2 games, while the Giants are in Arua, and there will be a reunion. Viani Seka Jogo will be, of course, playing against his former employees in Ondu Paraka. Let's hear from Fahad Bayo, in form striker, new signing with the Venoms. As of now, he has lived up to the billing with his new club side in Vipers.
We are ready as a team, and I think the boys, they're in good shape, because me, I came late, I was at the national team, but I found them there, they're in good shape. And I think we are going to win it. A striker is being calculated by scoring goals. I think it motivates me as a player. And I think I won't stop scoring, because that's what I'm meant to do.
Time and again, Brown, we've struggled to see typical number nines. We never have false nines in Uganda or in the UPL, but you struggle to see players at Vipers, number nines at Vipers, be consistent. We saw Muzei Serunkuma, I think, try to be that. We saw Tito Okello. We saw Meresasaki Sambu. There was another, actually, that came out, and it just didn't work out for them, because at some point, we saw Leku as well, Alfred, a very outstanding player, exciting player. But when they get to St. Mary's Sitende, something about them doesn't click, especially when it comes to big games like the one that that is about to unfold against Villa. Villa right now enjoying time in the UPL from what we saw last season. This season looks like a whole different Villa side. But for the striking department and Vipers, it's never consistent in that regard.
Yeah, I think over time, like you mentioned, Villa have had have had to look at all the other options, and once in a while they've had guys like Farouk Mia also came in and started leading goals,
well,
even when they were not entirely centre forward. So you think they've not entirely always had the best centre forward. I think Muzaidan Serunkuma has done an incredible job for the last two seasons. Now they've brought Mohamed Shaban, so certainly the mantle is going to be shifting towards him and Fahad Bayo. Can they carry this team through? Because we all know for any team that is battling for the championship, you need at least one go-to guy in terms of scoring the goals, and he'll need to give you between 10 and 15 goals if you're going to stay consistent. We've seen KCCA having, Geoffrey Serunkuma at some point. They've had Patrick Kadwa at some point. They've had, Derek Nsibambi at some point. Most recently, they brought in Sadata Nakwi. I yet to see him clicking. So for any team that is battling for the title, which I would suppose Vipers is supposed to be doing, they'll need a center forward that's going to be consistent for them, that is going to score for goals for them, and certainly be able to carry the team. And then all the other midfielders can come in a sense of being a support cast. But you need that one guy. And I think for me, though, Shaban is going to have to be that guy for the team.
And Shaban as well being another addition on that list. But for Edward Gola, very, very happy man so far in regards to what Vipers have achieved. They will be title contenders. They've got to be title contenders, especially with the CAF games for next season. For Gola, it's important that they get 3 points later tonight.
I've prepared these boys physically and mentally, and I think and I hope if they can put whatever we have taught in place, there's no doubt we shall get the win. And these 2 weeks have been a task that we have managed to play four friendly matches, and we have won only four. And two, it has helped us to, most of our players were in injuries, and now they have recovered in these 2 weeks.
Mourinho has actually shown so much faith in that man right there. Every time they have a sacking, he's always there to, you know, to do backup. But for what Gola has tried to build is a team that has identity, a team that actually that carries philosophy. In that regard, for Vipers, they've pretty much signed all the big names that need to be signed, including their latest in, of course, Mohamed Shaban. Do we see them kind of produce or have that culture in them, the philosophy in them, that identity in them? Seeing out Villa tonight will be a plus, but the way they will see them out will also be very, very key.
Yeah, it's going to be very important how they get the result, but you speak of this Vipers team, and I think for me, as much as they've got a couple of faces that have come through the door, they've also lost some key players, most recently Tadeolo Anga as well, leaving the club, and that in itself leaves quite a massive void for the team. But the head coach, Edward Gola, there, speaking about players that have been out injured, I think for me, one of them has got to be the utility player Geoffrey Waswa, who most recently came back from injury, and is the kind of guy that can give you cover in the back line and through the midfield as well. So if you've got players like that, they come quite in handy for any coach, and I think he'll be excited by the kind of crop of players he's got. But they come up against an AC Villa team today. That game is going to be played under the floodlights. That is at Nambole at 8 p.m. Villa have played already two games under the floodlights, one of them being against Chetume on opening day. They lost that, and they win against Imbara City. So you think for Villa, they'll be hoping that they can build on some of the positives. You all know it's a whole different dynamic playing under the floodlights, and more often than not, for a team that is not entirely used to it, it might be a bit of a challenge. But I think for me, Villa, in terms of quality, have still got a lot wanting, even when at some point they've gone top of the log. But it's one of those where you think they are still far from being the team they're supposed to be.
Tonight, of course, not tonight, but this evening for KCCFC, knowing that they had a very disappointing run, especially in their last game against the side in Petrol, they had won. They are desperate to get back to winning ways in terms of getting back to where they think they belong on the pile. But tonight, this evening, it will not be an easy walk for them against a very sloppy and tired side in Toro, who have literally not really, you know, delivered at the moment.
Interestingly, KCC are going to Toro at the St. Paul's Seminary in Fort Porto, and it reminds me of last season when KCC went there. They were knocked out of the Uganda Cup, though they were playing at the Buhinga. So for Toro, they as well be desperate for the win, because I think for me, for head coach Waswa Bosa, his boys have not had the kind of start that they had last season. So they've got a couple of things to pick up here and there. Obviously, they were forced to play away from home at the beginning of the season. It looks like that is out of the way now. They can focus on the games. And I think for me, it's going to be a very exciting game. You mentioned KCC, you know, being knocked out of the CAF Champions League by Petro de Rwanda, and you're thinking they've got to come up with the response in this particular game. And I'm thinking for Mike Mutebi as well. He knows that the earlier the results start come through for them as a team, game, the better. So it's going to be quite the exciting game, and it's going to be interesting, the kind of atmosphere now that Torre United can create back home in Fort Portal, because they tend to be quite the unbeatable team, and they create a fortress when they're playing there.
For Wakiso Giants, it is, of course, a long trip to Arua to face the Katsavilas and Odu Paraka. The atmosphere down there will tell the story like it has been the case in the last couple of years. But for Odu Paraka, it's important to win games now that they have actually have had their games return back to the Greenlight Stadium.
Yeah, actually, if Onu Paraka win this game, they have the opportunity to go top of the standings, which I think would be quite massive for them. It's going to be quite the mixed feelings for some of the players, including Karim Ndogo and obviously Vian Sekajiko, who are formerly at Onu Paraka. And I think for me, it's one of those where I can't wait to see what happens, especially if they get find the back of the net. But looking at Onu Paraka, it's going to be interesting to see the fans in Arua, because after they made the standard set by FUFA, all they've been waiting for is to get back home and suddenly start delivering results. So it's going to be a tricky game. Wakiso Giants don't come into this game on the back of two games where they failed to pick up results. And we know when they play back home in Wakiso, they tend to be a bit unplayable. But on the road, that is where the question marks have been. And the question is, can they go to Arua under a very fierce atmosphere and come back with a positive result?
And there's been questions about whether Kiffa Kisala will last the season with Wakiso Giants, because yes, the resources have been availed. He's gotten the right signings, I think. And then, of course, the beat of where Wakiso Giants will seemingly struggle to get results away from home. The sort of picture they've painted so far at their home in Wakiso Resource Center is quite convincing, but what's not convincing is playing away from home.
I think for any of the teams that are coming from the second tier, including Chetume, including Poline, including Wakiso Giants, if they are going to stay in the top flight, then they are not going, they're going to need to have very good performances at home. And that is something that you can build on playing away from home. But you speak about the players that have come through. You know, they've got Muzei, actually Geoffrey Serunkuma coming through at the club. They've got Vian Sekajiko coming through through the door as well. You think these are proven serial goal scorers. And at the end of the day, these are the guys that they'll be relying on. But Kefa as well is quite experienced, though his most recent stints have not been quite that impressive, you know. So you have a sense that he'll also have a thing to prove. And I would think the target this season for a team like Wakiso is going to be, can we stay in the top flight? And then everything else will actually come after that.
Well, I'll tell you what. Those are the three fixtures that will be happening later on this afternoon. Two this afternoon, and then, of course, the other being later on tonight. Under the floodlights, the Jogos and AC Villa, the 16-time league champions, get to rub shoulders with the former league champions, the Venoms, in Vipers Sports Club. The other, of course, being Odu Paraka, set to welcome the Wakiso Giants of Kiffa Kisala. And then, of course, the reigning champions in Kampala, Capital City Authority Football Club, side of Coach Hilary Mike Mutebi, will be away to Toro United. Away from that, let's now go ahead to the UEFA Champions League from last night. Quite the story. London fell. Why? For simple reasons. Bayern Munich came out with a scintillating run, 7 goals past Mauricio Pochettino's side. That, for me, tells the story of one side was simply better than the other. And of course, we talk about how outstanding and relentless the blistering pace of Gnabry was, outpacing Tottenham backline. But you've got to question Tottenham Hotspurs. Yes, they had a very rusty campaign from last season, a similar start as well, but somehow recovered, bounced back, and went till the finals before they lost out to Liverpool.
Yeah, they had an incredible run last season, obviously beating up on some big sides, including Ajax, on their way to get to the finals. But I'm looking at Bayern Munich and I'm thinking Bayern have somehow found a formula on beating up on English sides, because even before playing Tottenham last night, we all remember in 2017 they played against Arsenal, 5-1, 5-1 twice before the LD turned to an aggregate. So you can clearly see that, you know, Bayern Munich tend to become very fierce when they come down to London. And I think for me yesterday, you know, Robert Lewandowski was having an absolute outing. Certainly, Serge Gnabry, though, being the name that everyone should be looking out for. And to think that a couple of years ago, he was an outcast at Arsenal, and he's ever since gone around back home in Germany and turned his fortunes around, coming home with 4 goals in there. The 2 goals coming from Tottenham, obviously from Harry Kane and Son Heung-min. You feel like Tottenham lacked that thrill, especially going up front. They didn't have that cutting edge altogether. And then their backline, they've somehow got to sort it out, because it looks like there is absolutely nothing to take away from them. They've been absolutely very poor in the backline. The goalkeeping department as well, Hugo Lloris seems to be shipping in goals left, right and centre. And then I noticed the thing about their midfield is that Harry Winks, who plays as the holding midfielder, has quite the burden. And most of the time, he's supposed to receive a bit of help, either from Sissoko or, you know, and Ndombele. And most of these midfielders don't have the discipline to come back and help out. And you could see time and again, and that midfield was being overrun by the pace that guys like Serge Gnabry have got.
Captain Harry Kane unhappy, according to reports from North London. And that story, of course, will get uglier if Tottenham don't start winning title. That is something he wants to start building on at age 26. He doesn't have too much time as a striker in terms of starting to win silverware. Despite getting playing time, despite getting the goals, he needs to show something for it, and that something will be silver. Something Tottenham is not willing to offer. That conversation gets to continue right after this break.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game on is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.